Mic check. There we go. Hallelujah. How is everybody today? You ready for the word? Amen. How many of you have been at a gathering? Let's say it's Thanksgiving, Christmas, whatever family gathering. You have family members that they're doing real good. They're happy. And then just like that, they turn. In the midst of the gathering, it's like, what did I say? What did I do? And they just turn and they get an attitude. How many of you have been those people before? What we see with in Exodus 15, first of all, we see in Exodus 14, the children of Israel complaining because they left Egypt, but Egypt came after them. Satan isn't just going to leave you alone. He's going to always come after you. Doesn't mean we have to be afraid and run after Satan. Just now, we got to stand and believe God. But what the children of Israel did is they started crying. And so Moses went to God, and God told them, tell the people to stop crying and move. I like that kind of word. I would like to give that word to people sometime. Anybody else? Stop your crying and move. Amen. Hallelujah. Pastor Steve is more of the gentle, kind type of pastor that will hold your back and give you a nice, comforting word. Mine's, get up and move. Go, put it behind you and move on. Need a little balance of both sometimes, right? So that's what's happening here. God, they did decide to move. God did a miracle, open up that Red Sea. They went across it. Then he closed the Red Sea, crushing the horse and the rider. And so what do you think would happen if you saw that kind of miracle take place? If your enemies were destroyed, like Jesus did destroy them because of what he's done, what should be our attitude? We should celebrate. And that's about what's to happen here in Exodus 15. The first 22 verses is a song. So that's why we still have our praise and worship team back here, because I'm not going to say the song, I'm not going to sing the song, but they will. So let's sing the song of Moses. Anybody that song brought you back a little bit? Me, I grew up with that song. That song was played back in my beginning days of knowing the Lord. Fun song. But the kind of song I would like for a celebration is a song that was sang forth in Philadelphia a couple weeks ago when the Eagles won the championship, and the song was called We Are the Champions. Amen. Not the most godly song, but it was fitting for the moment, right? So this song that we just heard, it was all about giving credit to God for what he has done. He is the source of strength, the source of victory. Who is like the Lord? Glorious in holiness, awesome in splendor, performing great wonders. It is his unfailing love and his might that leads and guides his people to safety. That is something to celebrate about, amen? The goodness of God. And so that's what they were singing. And praise God for that. And that's what we saw here. You know, we're talking about celebration, how people quickly turn from celebration to complaining. What we see with the children of Israel, first they were complaining, now they're celebrating, and later in this chapter, they're going to go back to complaining again. Philadelphia fans are known to be very passionate. It can be either good or bad, but it's passionate. When things are good, they let it be known. When things are bad, they also let it known. So it's great to see after 40-something years since the 52 years since the Eagles won a championship. This was their first Super Bowl that it erupted, and it's still erupting in this area. People are still so excited. They're still living on it. Still probably talking about it. Still probably drinking as they're talking about it. But they're having a good time. But what was great about it all, see, yeah, it's just football. But anything is an opportunity to give God glory. And though it's just a sport, it is a platform. Everything is a platform. We have an audience here of a couple hundred people. Nick Foles had an audience of millions. And when the mic was given to him and the trophy, he didn't just, look how great I am. He gave God glory. Just like we see here with the children of Israel, they're giving God glory for what he has done. So thank God on this team. But this is also, you know, it was an opportunity not just to celebrate a sport, but to also celebrate God. Because it was really a miraculous journey for them to win this title. They were truly the underdogs. And we are God's underdogs. What did we come from? What did we come out of? Where have we been? What have we been through? And look at where we're at today. God's underdogs. We have something to celebrate. And that's what I'm going to teach in this first part. How do we live a life of celebration? How can we be different than the world? The world is up when things are good and down when things are bad. Just as quickly as the Eagles did so well, if next year, that picture's up somewhere, if you can get down to that next Eagles picture. If things don't start off that well next year, they start losing. And the coach starts, even though everybody loves the coach right now, what if he starts making some bad plays? He'd put some pretty radical plays. If it didn't go well on that fourth down, what if it doesn't go well? How quick people turn. We are called to be different. We've been called out of the world. We're not like the world. We're not moved by the atmosphere of the world. We're the ones to change the world. Now, this series is called A Movement of God's People. What we're learning is, through the book of Exodus, we all want to see a move of God, but we're learning how to move with God. Because there is no move of God if we don't learn how to move with God. So that's what's happening here. The children of Israel have left Egypt. They've crossed over now, and they're in the wilderness. The first thing they do is they celebrate. Just like when we got saved, most of us, it was an amazing moment. It was one of those moments we'll never forget. But has it been easy? Has there been a lot of hard times? Sometimes even things get harder. Now, there's things that you used to do and you didn't feel bad about doing. Now, all of a sudden, you're convicted. Now you don't feel right doing it. So now they're in the wilderness, and now there's this process. We're on this journey. God wants to get us to a place where life is always a celebration, where we learn to walk in the joy of the Lord. Because the Bible says that in His presence is the fullness of joy. And the joy of the Lord is our strength. So if we're in God's presence, we should have joy. So why and what causes us to get out of God's presence? What moves us? Why do people move us so much? Why do situations move us so much? What is really our issue? And that's what we're going to find here as they're moving. But the first part here is learning how to celebrate. And so how do we do that? Our challenge really is all about how we see things. See, everything is on how you see it. One person sees something one way, another person sees it totally a different way. How do we see things? What is the lens that we see life through? Do we see everything through the eyes of the world, or do we see things through the eyes of the Word? See, the challenge is fear or faith. The world is fear. The Word brings faith. When we learn to see everything through the eyes of faith, what was big now looks small. Every problem now is an opportunity. That's what happens. So how do we grow in faith? If you're having a problem, and I believe many of us do, we have a lot of ups and downs. Can we just be honest? How many of us, come on, have a lot of ups and downs, ins and outs? So what we're learning here today is how can we have more ups than downs? It's really in all how we see things. But if our seeing things is going to change, if our eyesight is going to change, it all depends on what we put in here in the heart. Out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaks. What do we put in the heart? What do we allow in the ears and in the eyes? Now, we can't control always our circumstances, but there is a lot of time that we can control what we hear and what we see. What are we doing with that time? How much word are we taking in? See, it says here in Colossians 3:16, let the word of Christ dwell in you richly, teaching and admonishing one another in all wisdom, singing songs and hymns and spiritual songs with thankfulness in your hearts to God. It also says in Joshua 1:8, my favorite verse, meditate on the word day and night, and then you'll be successful and prosperous in all you do. When we see everything through the word, it changes your whole eye, changes your whole view, and all of a sudden, you can live a celebrative life. That's the life I want to live. You know, I see my son Israel sometimes, actually all the time. He's really quiet in school and quiet in church sometimes, but when he's home, it's like he puts it all that bubbling over of excitement. The boy loves life, and he is loud about it. He's just smiling, happy, loving life, and sometimes you just want things to be quiet at home. But it's bubbling over, and that's what happens when you let the word of Christ dwell in you richly. There's this bubbling over of joy. Songs just come out. Even if you're not a singer, you just have a song in your spirit. You have an excitement. You just have an expectation of God to do great things every single day. You know, when my idea in the world of having a good time is I thought I had to always drink wine. Really, it was drink liquor. My favorite booze was Bacardi 151. If I'm going to drink, I don't want to just drink for the, you know, I want to get drunk. And I want to get drunk quick. Because in my mind, that's how what I had to do to have a good time. Because that's the perspective of the world. Life isn't really good, so the only way you can have a good time is put a substance in you that numbs all the pain and allows you to see things differently through spirits. That's the to actually call boo spirits. Who wants other spirits in them but the Spirit of God? That's why Ephesians 5:18 says, "Be not drunk with wine, which leads to debauchery." You feel good, but you don't feel good afterwards because of the stupid things you do. But be filled with the Spirit. When I gave my life to the Lord, I was filled with the Holy Spirit. I just lost the desire for booze because I had the boldness of God now. I had the peace of God. I had everything I needed. Booze could never do it. God could. So if we're going to live this life of celebration, that's the key. We got to know the Word, and we got to be filled with the Spirit. You got to know the Word, and you got to be filled with the Spirit. And it has to be a daily choice to do that. Daily, we got to get in the Word, and daily, we got to get refilled. You can't wait till Sunday morning. Can't wait till Wednesday night. It can't just be, this is it. If this is it, trust me, you're going to be complaining all the time. Do you know some people that just can't help but complain? It's like they're even maybe got a degree in complaining. No matter what they hear, they can find something to complain about it. Even if it's good, it turns into something bad. So we don't want to be like those miserable Eagles fans. When things turn bad, we get bad. So let's look at Ephesians chapter 15, verse 24. So now they had left the celebration, the party, and they moved on. And the first place that they go is a place called Mara. Mara in the Greek means bitter. They had partied, they had sang, they'd celebrated. Usually when you sing and you celebrate, you get thirsty. So they were thirsty. And when they got to Mara, the only kind of water that was there was bitter water. So what did they do? Now they just saw 10 plagues, miracles, the Red Sea opened. So what's going to be the response? Are they going to turn to God in their need, or are they going to go back to complaining? Verse 24. Then the people complained and turned against Moses. When you're a leader, everybody likes to blame you for all their problems. Anybody here like to be a leader? But the reality is, in Christ, we're all leaders because we're all leading people to God. So Moses cried out, or first they said, "What are we going to drink?" they demanded. So they were going to Moses and complaining to Moses. Moses, being a good leader, didn't get moved by the people's complaints, but he went to God. And he cried out to the Lord for help. And the Lord showed him a piece of wood. That's going to be significant, wood. Think of wood, because it's the only way to get free from bitterness, the cross. Moses threw it into the water, and this made the water good to drink. So here we have this situation. In life, it's full of challenges. It's easy to be celebrative when things are good. But what about when the challenge comes? What about when something isn't the way we like it? What about when somebody close to us turns against us? How do we handle that? Well, in every situation, we got to look at it like Moses did. He turned to God. Every problem is an opportunity for a miracle. Every impossible situation is an opportunity to see God do the impossible. So it's a good thing. Every challenge is a good thing. Every test can lead to a promotion. We got to see life that way. It's not easy to say, "Hey, praise the Lord. I just found out my relative got cancer." We're not going to say that out loud, but we're going to turn to God and say, "Lord, I thank you that because of this cancer, my relative is going to get healed. And it's going to be such a testimony that my whole family is going to get saved." That's how we need to see things. Amen? See, when bitterness is within someone, when we have any kind of bitterness still within, you say, "You know, I'm trying to stop complaining. I just can't." The only way we can stop complaining is to root out bitterness. The fruit of bitterness is complaining. So the only way we get rid of complaining is to get rid of bitterness. Has anybody had a yard that, you know, it's almost springtime, thank God, 66 today, beautiful. It's almost springtime, and that's the time we start pulling out weeds. This kind of weed, we don't need to wait till springtime. It's time that we allow Holy Spirit to pull this weed out now. And the weed is bitterness. As long as we hold on to any unforgiveness in our life, we still have a foot back there. And the only way you can move forward out of Mara is both feet. So until we pull that foot out of Mara, we're not going to move forward. And many people, they're saved, but they're stuck in Mara. They're living their life in Mara. God has a better place. We're going to see. He wants us to get to Elam. But we're stuck in Mara. The only way we can get out of Mara is by applying the blood. Applying the blood in every single hurt and pain of our past. Now, some of the pain goes deep, and it doesn't happen overnight. We have to go to God every day for forgiveness towards certain people. And we still feel it, but it's a process. That's what the wilderness is all about. It's a process. It's a process. So you can't just expect, hey, you went forward today, you got prayer, you left, you're absolutely, everything's absolutely perfect now. No. You might wake up tomorrow still feeling horrible. But what are you going to do with it? You're going to meditate on it? You're going to focus in on it? Or are you going to surrender it again and again and again and again every day until it's gone? See, bitterness is a virus that you can only get healed from through the wooden cross. Just like that piece of wood that was a prophetic symbol of what Christ was going to do. The only way we can drink pure water. We're talking about spirits. God wants us to drink only from the Holy Spirit. But when we allow bitterness, there's a mixture. And so some of us have a mixture inside. The water's not pure. The Holy Spirit's not able to flow because of that bitterness that needs to be uprooted. Only again by applying the blood, offering forgiveness, can it be uprooted and pulled out of the heart. Let's look at verse 25b and 26. It was there at Mara that the Lord set before them the following decree as a standard to test their faithfulness to him. See, we also got to see it that way. Everything we go through is only a test. I had a big test, a real test yesterday, a math test. Now, I've avoided math for 25 years since I've graduated high school. I went through Wagner Leadership Institute and got a bachelor's degree in spiritual things because I didn't have to take math. But I was challenged in this church by different people to get my degree with all my courses I've taken through the years. And so I'm working towards a bachelor's degree in religion. So these were my last courses. So I finally had to take math. And I got a tutor, Joshua Cooker was my tutor. He helped me through, and that's the key. Some tests, you can't handle it on your own. You need tutors, and sometimes we're trying to handle it on our own. There's certain things that we just can't get past. We just can't get through. We need the support, and that's why we're not just me and God. No, we're part of a body made up of many different members, and there's somebody that God has put in our life, if we open our heart to them, that can help us through it. So Joshua helped me, and oh, I'm telling you, I was just satisfied with getting a D. I took my final yesterday, and it was as miserable as I thought it would be. First of all, I thought I had all these online calculators. And the person said, you're going to have this one and that one. Actually, you cannot have any online calculators. So all I had to rely on was my basic calculator. And this was hard math. So I prayed, God, I just need a pass. Help me. And thanks be to God. Hallelujah. I got a D, but for the course, I got a C. Hallelujah. Thanks be to God. I passed the test. I'm moving on. I'm leaving it behind me. I never have to take math again. And there's some tests in our life that we're taking over and over again. And God wants us to finally get to a place where we put it behind us and it's gone. It's gone, it's gone, it's gone. Say goodbye, Maranatha, goodbye, I'm moving on. Hello, amen? That's right, so listen to this part, this is key. Verse 26, he said, if you will listen carefully to the voice of the Lord your God, because that's how you get out of it. That's how you get free of it. That's how you even recognize what you're really dealing with. And do what is right in his sight, obeying his commands. You got to know his commands to obey them. You got to know the word. And keeping all his decrees, then I will not make you suffer any of the diseases I sent on the Egyptians, for I am the Lord who heals you. Just because we're saved does not mean we're not going to suffer what other people suffer. We're going to experience the same things other people experience. The only way we can get out of those things is by applying the word. But we got to know the word. If we don't apply the word in every problem we face, the consequences of that problem will come upon us just like it would anybody else. The only difference, see, the safest place in the world is on the path of God. But to be on the path of God, you got to know the way of God. And to know the way of God, you got to know the word of God. And only then can you be in the will of God. And when you're in the will of God, you're in the safest place. Doesn't mean everything is always perfect and, you know, great all the time, but you see it totally different. You get through it totally different. You handle it completely different. Things are just completely different. So the key is we got to get on that path. We got to know God's voice, and we got to know how to do things right. Some of us expect God to do things for us, and yet we're not doing things right. Some things aren't the simplest thing. Sometimes it's we don't pay our taxes, but we think God's going to bless us. Sometimes we steal from our job little things, and we think God's going to take care of us. But I prophesy. I do this, I do that. But what about the little things? That's what we got to deal with, amen? So how do we know we passed the test? You know when you pass the test of bitterness, and it does take time, but you know when the person that wronged you comes near you and you don't lose it. When the thought of your past resurfaces in your mind, and both those situations, whether it be a thought, whether it be a person that comes near you, instead of turning to anger, you turn to God. Instead of complaining and crying, you pray. In sincerity, then you know you've moved on. Then you know what is next. Verse 27, after leaving Marah, bitterness, the Israelites traveled on to the oasis of Elim, where they found 12 springs and 70 palm trees. I didn't even know that Elim Bible College is probably named after the scripture. I just got it when I was reading it, of course. The oasis of Elim, where they found 12 springs. Now they had abundance of clean water. And 70 palm trees. They had covering. They had shade. They had safety. They camped there. They dwelled there besides that water. And that's where God wants his people to dwell. He wants us out of Marah, and he wants us in Elim. What this reminds me of is one last story. Anybody know the story of Mephibosheth? Jonathan's son. David made a vow to Jonathan that he would bless his descendants, that he would make a place for them in the palace. And all of Jonathan's relatives had been killed except for this, his son. And his son had been crippled. He had fallen. And so he was neglected and not taken care of well, and he was put in this place called Lodabar. Now the Lodabar, what it means in the Greek, means wasteland. A place of desolate. It's desolate. It's hot. It's miserable. He was a miserable person. And when David found out that there was this son, he told his people to go get him. And he took Mephibosheth out of Lodabar and brought him into the palace. Some of us here this morning are in Lodabar, and God is calling you right now to the palace. Will you take his hand? To take his hand, what does that mean? Everything in this hand, that means all bitterness, all unforgiveness must be released to take the Lord's hand and to walk with him into that place. So let's pray. Father, we thank you, Lord God, for your love and your mercy. We thank you, Lord, that you love us unconditionally. Even in Mara, you love us. Even in our bitterness, you love us. But you have so much more for us. I pray, Lord God, for every one of us today that we would take your hand. If there's any remnant of our past still in us, still lingering, there's any area of unforgiveness still in our life, we pray, Lord God, that you would set us free, Lord. And we know, God, you've already set us free. All we have to do is surrender. I pray, God, Holy Spirit, give each person the power, the grace to do just that, to surrender. Let us hold nothing back no more, but surrender our whole hearts to you. You want us to be a people that know and live in the place of joy, to live in Elam where there's safety, where there's water that we can drink from, that we never thirst again, contentment, life, and life abundantly. Pour out your spirit upon each one and have your way in Jesus' name. Amen.